Right on.
All right. Well, I'm pleased to be joined by Jared Anderson, Regional Safety Director for Adelson and Peterson here in town. And we're going to talk a little bit about construction safety. It's a timely topic since this is Construction Safety Week. And so, Jared, first of all, thanks for joining me today. How have you been doing?
Been doing well. Thank you for having me. It's nice to be here. It's nice to have the sun shining for us. Finally, it's been pretty doom and gloom over the past couple of weeks, which hasn't led to great success on construction sites, as you can imagine, but the sunshine is a big welcome for us.
Yeah, for sure. I'm geared up for baseball and everything else. My son is in Little League, and they finally have some decent weather for practices. So,
I'm right in the same boat with you there.
Yeah, very cool. Can you talk a little bit, just I guess by way of introduction, talk a little bit about your current job and your duties and how long you've been in this line of work?
Yeah, absolutely. Like you said, my current role is Regional Safety Director for Adelson and Peterson. I actually went to school for this role, so graduated from University of Minnesota Duluth with a master's in environmental health and safety back in 08, and then from there did an internship with the Department of Transportation, so worked for MnDOT for a while, got a gig with working on the OSHA side of things for about 2 years. And then from there, I went to oil and gas, worked in heavy industrial construction for 8.5 years and transitioned into Adelson and Peterson from the refinery world. I couldn't do shutdowns anymore. Didn't want to do that. And I've been with Adelson and Peterson ever since. So been with A&P going on 4 years coming up in October, and over two of those have been in the role that I'm in right now.
Okay. And can you tell me a little bit about some of the specific things you're working on right now with A&P in terms of the safety program? What does that look like?
Oh, well, that's we could talk all day on that, but a lot of what I work on is just the day-to-day management of our current safety systems that are in place, making sure individuals have the appropriate training that they need to perform the tasks that they do, making sure that our training is up to date with the latest guidelines and regulations, because those don't change from time to time. So you got to have your ear to the ground when it comes to the changes that are coming down the pike, to ensure that we are regulatory compliant. And that's a huge part of my job too, is from a regulatory standpoint, safety is highly regulated. There's OSHA that's out there, and the Code of Federal Regulations, that's a book about this thick that we have to follow if it applies to us. So making sure that our individuals are trained on everything that's applied, We're regulatory compliant. Our policies and procedures are up to date. We have a lot of high risk situations that we deal with in construction. So there's safety plans that need to be addressed on a daily, weekly, monthly basis when those types of things come up. And then the other aspect of it is just getting out and being visible. That's a huge part of safety. Is I consider myself a resource more than anything for our individuals who are out there in the field. Well, not only the people in the field, but people in the office too. Everybody has questions when it comes to safety. Not everybody knows everything, including myself. And I like to be the resource for those individuals when they do have those questions, because there are tricky situations that come up sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one of the things that we've all been dealing with in the past couple of years is the pandemic, and I'm curious how that changed your approach to what you do, and what are some of the lessons learned there?
Well, yeah, again, that did change everything quite a bit. But, everybody was kind of forced to change really quickly as well. I guess one of the biggest things that we had to figure out is how to train our individuals. You know, usually, historically, it was, let's get everybody in the same room, let's sit them down, let's train them on a certain topic, and send them on the way. That kind of went out the door when COVID came around. Obviously, you couldn't get people in the same room for obvious reasons. So we had to learn how to utilize technology really quickly to do some effective training. We developed a learning management system that has been an excellent tool in our tool chest. And essentially what that is just it's a online database of training sources that we have that are specific to the construction industry, that anybody who comes on and is an employee of Adolphson and Peterson can sign into, has a profile. We can assign, you know, specific trainings based upon the type of work that individual is doing. And it covers everything from safety-related topics to mental health to, you know, tips and tricks on how to use processes that we have within our within the company of AP. So that's one of the biggest kind of things that we've had to evolve on from a COVID standpoint.
Yeah, you mentioned mental health, and that's a very serious thing that I think people don't realize how important that is. We all hear about the fall protection and things of that nature, which of course is very important, but can you just touch on a little bit of the topic of mental health and what are you looking for, certain signs there, or just how do you promote good mental health in your workforce?
Part of that goes back to what I touched upon a little bit earlier is knowing your people and getting out there and talking to them. If you don't do that, you're going to lose touch with from a number of different aspects, but you can't really understand the state of mind that somebody is in without actually engaging those individuals. So that's part of trying to put your finger on the mental health issue. I mean, there's a lot of aspects to this too, because it was a little bit of a sleeping giant for us in the construction industry. You know, people didn't know, or at least it wasn't widely communicated previous to COVID. COVID was kind of a catalyst that brought it about. And next thing you know, we're, you know, throwing around statistics that, you know, construction industry has one of the highest suicide rates, and with all of the other variables that COVID brought with it, it just brought that to the forefront. So going back to the kind of the crux of your question, we had to, you know, talk to our leaders on how to address this, because it's not an easy topic to bring up in a toolbox scenario. You know, when you're historically, we have toolbox talks that address task specific items like fall protection, to your point, or, you know, welding, excavations, things like that. But then you transition into a toolbox talk about mental health and, you know, awareness and things that you can do. You gotta prep your field leaders to have those conversations and even be ready for the conversations or the questions that would come back to them, because it doesn't come natural to everybody, and it's just a really different topic that we've historically talked about on our job sites. So we've just been trying to gather up as much resources as we possibly can. We've been getting involved in things like Mental Health Awareness Month, which is this month. Construction Safety Week, the topics that are that we're discussing are all about staying connected and being supported. And that ties in with Adolfson and Peterson's core philosophy of our incident and injury-free culture that we try to push. And what that's all about is just the foundation of success is building relationships with people. And that kind of gets back to the more you know somebody, the more personal conversations you try to have with them to get to know them, to understand what makes them tick, you're probably going to have a better idea of what sort of mental state they're going to be in from a day-to-day basis as well, instead of just being a robot about this is the process, this is what we have to do, this is the schedule. No, slow down. Take the time to talk to somebody. Take the time to get to know them. And I think a byproduct of that is ultimately going to be a better job site from a mental health standpoint, for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. And what other types of trends are you seeing out there in the industry? I guess let's talk about with equipment, for example. Are you seeing constantly evolving standards and improvements with regard to fall protection, gear, helmets, that sort of thing?
Yeah, the two that you mentioned there, there's certainly hard hats are, they're coming out with a lot of new innovations from a hard hat standpoint. You'll see a lot of climbing style hard hats that are being used more and more in different scenarios. Fall protection is, I mean, I can go to sleep for 8 hours and wake up the next morning and there's something new that's on the shelf from a fall protection standpoint. One of the big trends or the things that we're doing internally at AP is from a fall protection aspect is harnesses that have kind of built-in weight distribution systems. And that's not necessarily really new, but within the last 2-3 years, you've seen the technology develop and come along there where the harness helps distribute the weight. And it's a tremendous advantage for trades like carpenters who wear heavy bags, iron workers who have a lot of equipment on them as well, because it takes that weight off your shoulders and puts it down towards your core and just distributes it better, preventing musculoskeletal soft tissue injuries, things like that. A big push for the summertime is probably going to be heat and what types of mitigations we can put in place there. There's a national emphasis program that OSHA comes out with every year. This year they're focusing on heat stress. So that's a big thing in Minnesota. You might not, it may not seem like that right now with the weather that we've been having, but when it, you know, the humidity comes and we get the heat index levels up over, you know, 95 to, 100, and it can get up to 110, we don't acclimate well to that in Minnesota. So with that emphasis program, you're going to see OSHA out inspecting jobs, specifically looking for things like heat mitigation programs, and PPE comes into play there. There's cooling vests that you can use. There's cooling towels. So there's the construction industry is going to have to adapt to that one, because those things have been around for a while, but with that emphasis program coming into play, it's going to be looked at a lot closer under a microscope.
Yeah, for sure. And I'm always impressed when I go on a project site or do a tour by all the signage and the, you know, in both English and Spanish, and reminding people about safety and wearing a hard hat and everything else. And I think that's just I would imagine really important to have that out there. And especially, I think I've heard from different government statistics or, you know, it's probably more likely that you're going to have an accident, for example, maybe on a Friday afternoon when your mind is on the weekend or something like that. And you're, you know, it's important. I guess the point is the importance of staying focused. all the time on safety. Can you speak to that at all?
Yeah, absolutely. There's, one of the reoccurring safety talks and messages that we like to get out there is something that we call, I can't claim this, but it's the behavioral traps, so to speak, where you talk about fatigue, frustration, complacency, distraction, those types of things, and how they can kind of creep in to the job site. And it's a hard one to address, because you're almost trying to you are trying to combat human nature to a certain extent. But in my opinion, the more you talk about it, the more the level of awareness goes up about it. Because the hard part about, talking about complacency and distraction is, all right, once you've identified the problem and that's potentially an issue as to, how some incidents or a contributing factor to incidents, what's the action item for complacency, right? It's hard to come up with a tangible action item for that, as opposed to, apart from making sure it's on the forefront of people's minds and talking about it a lot. And the distractions one is certainly true, because we've all, that can be distractions on the job site, or it can be distractions that you're bringing to the job site with you. And that ties back to the state of mind individuals are in, mental health. They could be thinking about something at home or issues that they have going on. So that's the conversations that we like to have as well. It's, when you're here, be present. Be present on the job. And obviously, if you have things that you need to talk about and get off your chest, we're gonna offer an ear to you and help you out and help you through those and give you every resource that we possibly can. And that's part of knowing your people as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I guess just to sort of wrap things up a little bit, the benefits of good safety practices are obvious for reasons of just keeping people healthy and avoiding serious injuries. But can you also talk about some of the, I guess, other benefits to the company of having a zero injury culture and a good safety record?
Well, one of the biggest that comes to my mind right now is people don't want to work for an unsafe company. And word travels, and the environment that we're kind of in right now is the war on talent, right? And the great resignation, so to speak. If you're not a safe company, you're not going to retain your employees, and retention of good employees is extremely important right now, especially with what's going on in the industry and trying to find good individuals. So having those safe work practices, being known as a safe company, certainly helps us from a recruitment standpoint and an employee retention standpoint. I would say secondly, owners don't want to do work with companies that don't have exemplary safety records either. I don't know if it's hard pressed to find an owner that doesn't have some sort of pre-qualification parameters when it comes to safety that they judge, just like, the schedule that you present, just like the cost that you present on the job on the front end, they're taking safety into account when they're awarding projects out as well. So, and if you can't impress your owners from that standpoint, and you're not getting jobs from a safety perspective, then you're not supporting your employees from a financial perspective, because you're not running a healthy business. You're just not going to get work. So it comes full circle. I mean, there's absolutely, an importance to that on a number of different levels.
Yeah, it's fascinating stuff, and certainly a lot of layers to it. So thanks for helping us sort that out, Jared. Anything else that you would like to add before I let you go?
No, I just appreciate you giving me the opportunity to have a conversation. It's nice to meet a fellow Swede. I don't know too many people that are fluent in Swedish either. So it's, I found that very interesting, but thank you for having us.
Well, there you go. And tack så mycket. Thank you very much. It was nice meeting you, and it's good to meet someone from the Eveleth area as well. I always like to meet those Iron Rangers.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir, and have a great day. Hopefully we can chat again soon.
Yeah, anytime. You as well.
Thanks. Take care.
Talk to you later.
Bye.
Bye.